So the spectral analysis, capsule analysis, capsule smoothing, essentially involves smoothing a log power spectrum and retaining, which is equivalent to doing an inverse Fourier transform of the green curve here, log power spectrum, and retaining only the first few coefficients. Now, what it gives you is this purple curve, where it is easy to locate the frequency at which the peaks in the spectrum occur. These peaks in the spectrum are called formants by the linguist acoustic phoneticians. So in the case of the vowel E, let's look at the vowel E, the first form peak occurs at around 300 Hz. This first peak, we call it as a first formant. And the second peak, we call it as a second formant. The formant has the frequency, its amplitude, its bandwidth, and so on. Most of the time, for the sake of illustration, we will concentrate only on one feature, that is the frequency at which the peak occurs, or the formant frequency. The frequency of the first formant is 300 Hz, capital F1 is 300 Hz, capital F2 is 1800 Hz. This is the case of the vowel E. So F1 for the vowel E, first formant frequency at 300 Hz, second formant occurs at 2300 Hz in another case, and so on, some other E spoken by some other person. Now, if you want to speak the different sounds, so in this particular case, I have spoken a word, IA. It means, please come, that's in Hindi. So the IA consists of three vowels, A, E, A. Now, if I take the spectral response of the vowel E, I get formant frequency at 300 Hz and 2300 Hz. On the other hand, if I do a short segment of the speech waveform here and do the analysis, I get the formant frequency at 700 Hz and 1300 Hz. The vowel A. Please remember, in the case of the short vowel A, we expected the formant frequencies to occur at 500 Hz, 1500 Hz, and 2500 Hz. So the first two formant frequencies, the short vowel A, it should have occurred at 500 Hz and 1500 Hz. That's theory. And what we see here is not the short vowel A, but long vowel A, the formant frequency occurred at 700 Hz and 1300 Hz. There is some similarity between the prediction and what we actually observe. This is the vowel E, and the vowel A, if you look at the vowel A, its formant frequencies are slightly different from that of the vowel E. E and A, they are articulatory very similar. E, A, slight variation in the size and shape of the present cavity, therefore the formant frequencies are also slightly different. What is shown here in this graph is the spectrum, smooth log power spectrum of the vowel A. The vowel A in the red color, it has a peak at around 700 Hz, and the second peak at around 1300 Hz. On the other hand, if you take analysis of the vowel E, and that is the black curve, and the first formant occurs around 300 Hz, the second formant occurs at around 2300 Hz. If you look at the vowel A, which I have not shown here, its formant frequency occurs differently. So you see that different vowels have different formant frequencies, set of formant frequencies. Similar sounds, E and A, will have close by similar formant frequencies. Far away vowels, more distinct vowels such as E and U, they will have different frequencies. So one idea is to say that we can recognize vowels by using their formant frequencies. To put it in other words, formant frequencies can be considered as the signatures of the vowels. Using them, we can identify which vowels have occurred. So that is one way, that is why the locating the frequency at which the peaks occur is important. And the capital analysis minimizes the effect of the pitch and enhances the locations of the peaks, and that is useful for speech vowel recognition. It is true in general for all speech sounds, not just vowels, but also for consonants. Therefore, the capital analysis is the preferred way of, more popular way of analyzing speech sound for the purpose of recognition of the speech sound. So let's go back to the green color, the spectrum of the vowel E. It has the effect of the pitch and its harmonics, and it also has the effect of the resonances or the formants or the pole frequencies. Our intention in case of speech recognition was to ignore the effect of pitch and concentrate on the formant frequencies. On the other hand, sometimes you want to do the raga recognition, recognize tunes, in which case pitch frequency is more important. How does it vary? So computation or estimation of the pitch frequency is also important in some speech signal processing. In which case, what we want to do is the reverse or the ulta, where we want to ignore these effect of formants, but want to concentrate only on the rapidly varying components. So we want to retain the rapidly varying component in the log power spectrum and discard slowly varying components. So we do a high pass filter. So you do the high pass filtering of the log power spectrum, it yields pitch harmonics, minimizes the effect of formants, and that is useful for pitch estimation. So the capture analysis can be used appropriately for the either of the two types of estimation, whether it is you want to estimate pitch frequency or you want to estimate formant information. So that this capture analysis was done 4 or 5 decades ago, and the recognition of vowels was okay, but it was not as good. Then some scientists went and see, can we learn from the best speech recognizer, human ear? What does the human ear do? So this knowledge of what human ear does was known even before the computers came into existence. Physiologists have studied the response. So if you look at our human ear, there's an external ear here, and there is an inner middle ear, which consists of set of three bones, and there's an inner ear, which is primarily consists, the more relevant portion to us is a snail-shaped structure called cochlea. The cochlea is snail-shaped. Suppose for sake of illustration, you spread it out and see how the cochlea looks like. It consists of certain chambers. So this lower diagram shows, I again borrowed it from some place. So the eardrum, the three sets of bones, and the cochlea, which is curved. And cochlea consists of several chambers, which are fluid-filled. And the two of the three chambers are separated by a membrane. That membrane is called basilar membrane. And when the sound comes, it falls on our eardrum, and that vibrates, and the vibrations are passed on through these three bones to a window in this chamber, a window, and these vibrations go through this fluid. And these vibrations set up resonances. This fluid sets up resonances, and whenever there is the vibration of the fluid is maximum, the basilar membrane bends, and the nerves that are connected to this basilar membrane, they send nerve impulses to the brain. The brain knows that there is some this particular input audio signal contains some peak at that particular frequency, and so on. So this this cochlea is about 3 centimeters long or 30 millimeter long. Humans can hear sounds from 20 hertz to 20,000 hertz. This is called audible range. So what we first, our guess would be, okay, this is 30 mm long, so let's stretch it out. And the 30 mm long basilar membrane, first half would probably send information about the first 10,000 hertz, and the next half send information about the next 10,000 hertz. This is what we think of normally, the linear model. It's surprisingly, it does slightly different. By evolution, human auditory system, the cochlea, has evolved to pay more attention to low frequency sounds. Because when some leaf ruffles, maybe there's a predator that is coming in. Or the even the speech sounds, a lot of energy is at the low frequency. So the information about the frequency content, the ear does frequency analysis. And the information about the frequency content, the cochlea extracts more finer information about the lower frequency than the higher frequency. In other words, the frequency, to put it in some other way, the frequency resolution is better at low frequency. Resolution of the low frequency sound is much better than the resolution of high frequency sound. So if you look at this schematic diagram here, whenever, let's say, this particular place corresponds to, let's say, 1000 Hertz, suppose the input signal has a peak at 1000 Hertz, these basilar membrane bends much more here, lots of information, nerve impulses connected to this region rather than this region, and lots of information, therefore the brain knows there is a peak in the spectrum at 1000 Hertz. Now, this, so we assume we can, now how, so the different parts of the basilar membrane are sensitive to different frequencies. And this frequency sensitivity of the basilar membrane is not linear, but it is logarithmically linear. In fact, it can be shown that initially it will be almost linear up to about 1000 Hertz, and beyond that, the scale increases logarithmically. You see, 1 kilohertz, 2 kilohertz, 4 kilohertz, 8 kilohertz, 16 kilohertz, and so on. So, about half of the basilar membrane analyzes information up to 2 or 3 kilohertz. And 3 kilohertz to 20 kilohertz is managed by the rest, other half, which is about 15 millimeter long. So, lot of better analysis of the frequency content is done at the low frequency. So, the brain gets much more information about finer details about the lower end of the spectrum. This scale, which is nearly linear here and logarithmic, is called Mel scale. This is there in the music. For example, music scale is not linear, it goes square root, it's non-linear scale. So it's called melody scale, short Mel scale. It's also called Bark scale in honor of a scientist who studied this, and the result is that every nerve connected to this 30 mm long basilar membrane, there are 10,000 nerves that are connected. Each nerve sent information about not just one frequency, but a region of frequencies centered at one frequency. It's more sensitive to one frequency. Let's say this particular nerve sends lots of impulses when there is a 1000 Hertz, but it sends some information about when the frequency content is 950 Hertz or 1050 Hertz also. The width of this, so the bandwidth of the frequency response of this particular nerve is called 1 bar, and that bandwidth increases as the frequency increases. So that scale is also, scale is called Bark scale. So we know that the human ear does, there are some 10,000 nerves. They can be considered 10,000 bandpass filters. They send information about a region around one frequency. The center frequency of these bandpass filters vary. And not only do they vary, but the center frequencies vary in a logarithm scale. Their bandwidths also vary. So if you want to emulate the response of the human ear, and that's what some scientists did, and they took the log power spectrum and passed it through a series of bandpass filters whose center frequencies vary along the Mel, according to the Mel scale, which is a linear logarithm scale, and also bandwidths also increase with, as the frequency increases. So the log power spectrum is here, x of k whole square, and you find out the energy in the spectrum for in a, this is a bandpass filter, nth bandpass filter of the bar scale, finds out the energy between some low frequency and high frequency, which is its bandwidth, which is something like this. Energy in this low frequency to high frequency, but it is also weighted by a triangular filter. So the first band pass filter, B of 1, finds out the information energy in this frequency region. Second band pass filter finds out the information energy content in this band pass, in this frequency band, and the frequency bands continue, and there are about 30 to 40 such filters that are used emulating the frequency response, the Mel scale or the bar scale. So instead of doing the simple Kestrel analysis, in earlier case we were doing simple Kestrel analysis, in which case the waveform was speech signal came in x of n waveform, we do a frequency analysis, we get a power spectrum, we do the logarithm power spectrum, and then do the inverse Fourier transform, return over the first few coefficients. Now you introduce a block, extra block here, before the logger operation, but after the frequency analysis, where a series of Mel filters of this kind are introduced. So there is an extra term here, which is written in the red curve here. A Kestrel analysis, which takes into account Mel frequency scale, is called Mel frequency Kestrel coefficient. The Kestrel coefficients that it derived are called Mel frequency Kestrel coefficients, and this shows the block diagram of computation of the MFCC or the Mel frequency Kestrel coefficients. So this series of steps show how to derive the Mel frequency Kestrel coefficients starting from the waveform. You have a waveform, you take a short segment of the speech signal, if necessary you do a pre-emphasis to increase the strength of the higher frequency components, you do a windowing typically through a tapered window such as Hamming window, you do a Fourier analysis and pass the Fourier analysis through 40 band pass filters which are placed along the Mel scale, and then compute the logarithm of these values, so we get a log mod spectrum, do an inverse Fourier transform, return only the first few coefficients, values that you get can be positive or negative, these are called the Mel frequency Kestrel coefficients. So we talked about so much about the signal processing, and we'll talk a little bit about the speech sounds themselves. Some basic concept about the acoustic phonetics. Phonetics, phones, speech sounds, telephone, speech sounds. Phonetics is the study of the speech sounds. Acoustic phonetics. Phonetics has several, 2-3 branches. The one of them is acoustic phonetics, which is studies about the acoustic property of the speech sounds. So that is what we are talking about. The two key concepts are phones and phonemes. Talk of a phone. A phone is a speech sound that is used by a human being in for communication in a natural language. So a, e, u, e, ka, ka, these are two phones. So phone is, in that sense, language independent. It's independent of the language. It's a unit of speech sound used in some language. Phoneme, on the other hand, is a language dependent. Phoneme is a unit of speech sound which has a meaningful, which is a smallest meaningful contrast unit in phonology of a language. Phonology, study of the phone sound. Okay, let me and then we will introduce the term allophones. I'll describe, contrast this in a short while. Allophones. Let's consider the sound p and p. Pal versus pal. What is the difference? Instead of p, we are using a p here. Instead of p, we are using p. Some extra puff of air comes about. That is the distinction between p and p. This is an unaspirated sound. This is an aspirated sound. Aspiration means puff of air. Okay, pa versus pa. In Hindi, you substitute pa by pa, there are set of words where the meaning changes. So in this word, we just put extra puff of air to the pa, it becomes pal, the meaning changes. Pal is a moment, pal is fruit. Now, on the other hand, in the English language, so these are in the Hindi language, pa and pa are two phones, and they are also called phonemes. On the other hand, in English, you cannot find a pair of words where you put extra puff of air to pa, the meaning changes. You cannot find such pair of words. Therefore, those two sounds, pa and pa, are not two phonemes in English language. They are phonemes in Hindi language because you replace this sound pa by pha, meaning changes. They are not phonemes in English because you cannot find a pair of words where you substitute pa by pha, meaning changes. But, however, in English, these two are still phones. They are used in particular word context. For example, in English, you don't say, if you say the word pit, in Indians say pit, but English, whenever native British English speakers say it as pit. Whenever the P comes at the beginning of the word, it has to be pronounced with the extra aspiration. It should not be pronounced as pit, it should be pronounced as pit. It is not only true of P, but also of the other three unvoiced plosives, pa, ta, ka. So you don't say king, you say king. You don't say time, you say time. So because T comes at the beginning of a word. So if you just say pip, okay, there are two P's here. This P is to pronounce with the aspiration, pa. Whereas this P is not at the beginning of the word, so therefore it should pronounce without the aspiration. Pip. We don't say pip, no. We say just pip. So these two sounds, so this is actually pa, pa, whereas this is, and this is just normal pa. So it's the same symbol, but pronounced differently. So they are called allophones. They are not phonemes. But that's the basic distinction, some idea about the, some terminology that we use in phonetics. Now we'll look at this particular schematics. We talked about the voice box here, and that's called larynx, okay, laryngeal vocal cords. And this is called pharynx here, and there are various articulators. The body parts that take part in the production of these speech sounds are called articulators, because they take part in articulation. Lips and tongue and teeth and so on. Now, when I want to say, let's say the word pa, what do? I close my lips for a moment and then release it. So we say that the place of articulation of the sound pa is bilabial. Labial, lips, two lips are coming together, so that's called bilabial sound. On the other hand, if I want to say the sound ta, ta, now my tongue touches the upper teeth, so there is a stoppage of air occurs at the position of the teeth or denture, so the place of articulation of the sound ta is called dental. Similarly, you can talk of not just ta, but ta. So you can stop the flow of air at different places in this oral cavity. And the beauty of our Indian alphabet, Indic alphabet, let me say, I am using Devanagari script here, but it is true of all the scripts, Indic scripts. The beauty of them is that the place of the alphabet is arranged according to the people who organized this alphabet knew about this production of speech sounds. They organized the different sounds according to the stoppage of the air at various points or the place of articulation. The sound pa involves bilabial lips, therefore pa, pa, not only pa but also pa, ba, ba, ma. Ma also involves lips closing. So all these five sounds are said to have the place of articulation, bilabial place of articulation, or the labial. The ta, dental place of articulation. Ta, tha, da, dha. Now all these five sounds are produced, their production involves stoppage of the air at the teeth. Ta, this is called retroflex sound, our teeth. When you say the distinction between ta and ta, if you see, in case of ta, our tongue slightly curls back and touches the place somewhere here. Not the teeth, but somewhere here. It's called retroflex place of articulation. If you go to the cha, the tongue itself is doesn't touch here, but actually it makes a larger contact at the so-called palatal place of articulation. This place of articulation is called palatal. And in the case of ka ka ga ga ga, the stoppage of the air is somewhere here. It's called velum. The place is called velic place. The velum, because this articulation, this part is called velum. So these four, five sounds, ka ka ga ga ga, are called, their place of articulation is velar. So this is called the place of articulation. Now, if you look at our Indic alphabet, they are divided into sort of three blocks, roughly. The topmost one is all the vowels, and the second is the consonants. In the consonants, the middle part has a 5x5 matrix, and the rest of the consonants. In this 5x5 matrix, the rows represent the place of articulation, the place along the vocal tract where the stoppage of air occurs. What about the meaning of the columns? Yes, let's look at the columns themselves. Let's look at the pa. The first column represents the sound pa. The second column represents the same sound pa with some extra puff of air, the aspiration. Pa versus pa. So this is called aspirated sound. Now let's contrast pa and ba. Now I will, just for the sake of argument, I'll say a pa, where I say no sound comes. On the other hand, if I say a ba, even when I close the mouth, some sound you hear. That is because in the production of the sound ba, the glottis continues to oscillate, or the air keeps coming, puffs of air keeps coming from the lungs to the oral cavity, even though it is closed here. So when I say abba, my cheeks come out, it's bloat because the air is coming. Abba. So the production of the sounds, these sounds in these three columns, column number 3, 4 and 5, they all involve the vibration of the glottis. Air comes in packets. On the other hand, when you say pa, the glottis doesn't vibrate. Pa, no sound comes at all. How do you get this sound? It doesn't come out through the mouth, but the glottis continues to vibrate. The walls of this mouth continues to vibrate, and that sound comes through the air. So, the five columns are called manner of articulation. That is, when the sound is produced, whether the glottis vibrates, or glottis doesn't vibrate. What is the speciality of this fifth column? In this particular, glottis does vibrate, but this is a kind of wall. Normally, when we talk sound, this is closed. This goes up. No air comes through the nasal. On the other hand, when you say ma, air comes through my nostril. This opens up, lips are closed, but the air, glottis vibrates, air comes through the nose. What about the case of the na? In the case of na, my closure of is my tongue, lower tongue, goes and touches the upper denture. This opens, it closes, the air comes through the nostril. So the sounds in the fifth column are called nasal sounds because the air comes through the nose or the nasal pan. Indic scripts are organized based on the phonetic principle, based on the place of articulation and manner of articulation. Oh, first of all, vowels are at one place. All the so-called stop consonants, the 5x5, 25 consonants are in one block. They are the production of all these consonants involve stoppage of the air at some point in this vocal tract and the rest of the consonants. Even these 25 consonants are arranged according to the place of articulation and manner of articulation. The bilabial place of articulation, this row, this dental place of articulation, retroplace place of articulation, 5 closing sounds, 5 stop consonants, palatals, velar sounds. So the rows represent the place of articulation. And the columns represent the manner of articulation. This first column represents the stop plosives, stop consonants, which are unvoiced and unaspirated. The 5 sounds in the second column are unvoiced stops, but aspirated stops, unvoiced aspirated stops. The sounds, five sounds in the third column are voiced unaspirated stops. The sounds in the fourth column are voiced aspirated sounds. Sounds in the fifth column are called nasal sounds because that involves escaping of the air through the nasal passage. And even if you look at the other consonants, the four consonants here are voiced consonants, these are unvoiced consonants. The place of articulation, if you wish, sort of moves in again in some specific kind of direction. Whereas here also, if you look at the unvoiced sounds, this is the regular sa, the dental, the retroflex, palatal. And this is a ha sound, is a fricative sound that where the frication, the narrowing of the constriction is at the larynx. So that's about the organized properties of the different sounds based on voicing, place of articulation, and manner of articulation. All these ovules are called voice sounds, and all the sounds in the last three columns are also called voice sounds. All these are also called voice sounds because the production of that involve vibration of the vocal folds or the opening and closing of the vocal cords. On the other hand, the sounds in these first two columns and these four sounds are called unvoiced sounds because the production of their sounds does not involve the vocal cords. Vocal cords are kept open, at some point in the vocal tract, the passage of air is constricted. There is a narrow orifice through which the air rushes out. So these are called fricative sounds because they make hissing sound noise like s, yes. So these are called unvoiced sounds. So the unvoiced sounds should not have the effect of fundamental frequency vibration or the pitch frequency. Is it true? Let's look at it in the next slide. So I'm looking at the same word thirua, the sound ta and vowel e. Vowel e is voiced and its spectrum is given by this blue curve. You can see that the pitch frequency, fundamental frequency, it's second, first harmonic, second harmonic, and so on. So you see the periodicity even in this blue curve that corresponds to the spectrum of the oval voice sound E. On the other hand, ta is an unvoiced sound. When I say ta, actually there are two sounds, t and a. I'm ignoring the a, but just concentrating over there the sound t. And if you look at the spectrum of the sound t, which is unvoiced, the red curve shows that spectrum of the unvoiced sound t, and you don't see that kind of periodicity in the spectrum. So unvoiced sounds do not involve glottal vibration, so their spectrum doesn't show the pitch effect. Therefore, smoothing is not as important in case of unvoiced sounds. However, when we analyze this short segment of speech, we do not know whether it's voice or unvoiced. We proceed through the same male frequency capsule smoothing and compute the male frequency capsule coefficients. So far, we have been concentrating only on the time waveform, these audio signals, speech signal as captured by a microphone, time along the x-axis and amplitude along the y-axis. But we saw that the ovules appear similar, so if you want to distinguish between different ovules, it is better to compute their frequency properties, spectral properties. So now we have a spectrum involves two attributes, amplitude at various frequency components, power as a function of frequency. There are already two attributes there. Now you want to see how the spectrum varies with respect to time, because as time changes, different sounds are produced, their frequency properties change. So we want to see the frequency, temporal evolution of frequency spectrum. Now that object has three attributes, three variables: frequency, time, and amplitude. Frequency and amplitude and time, these are third. It's difficult to plot a three-dimensional object on a two-dimensional plane, a surface. Therefore, we need to do some trick, regularly, and what is done is results in what is called a spectrogram. Spectrogram, you may know already familiar with the term ECG, EEG. ECG stands for electrocardiogram, EEG stands for electroencephalogram. Essentially, they tell the state of the either the heart or the brain as a function of time. Similarly, a spectrogram shows the spectrum as a function of time. How does the spectrum vary as a function of time? What is done here is in order to show how the spectrum varies with the time and corresponding with the time waveform is shown here. In the spectrogram, the horizontal axis is time. This is milliseconds. The vertical axis is frequency. And the intensity is in the z axis or in this direction. And it, in this particular case, it is encoded using color. Red means high intensity, a peak in the spectrum. Green means medium intensity. Blue means valley, no intensity at that particular frequency. So, if you look at this particular time waveform, this is the word Thiruvananthapuram, Ta, E, R. If I look at the oval E, it if frequency goes like this, frequency at around 300 hertz, there is a red blob. So the peak is at around 300 hertz. That's the first format frequency of the oval E. Second format frequency of this particular oval in this particular context is around 1900 hertz. Third format frequency here and so on. Now, why do I have to show this? Because there's a purpose. Let me look at the oval E, O, and so on. The second oval here is oval O. The oval O approximately occupies this particular time interval. This is a time domain. Now, if you look at the frequency domain, the correspondingly, it also corresponds to the same time. In the frequency domain, this particular interval, this spectrum corresponds to the oval O. In written language, when you write O, it from here to here, it is O, the same O, no change. No change with respect to time. On the other hand, in spoken language, or in the speech signal, this O, its property can change. For example, let me draw this line straight. For example, if you look at the second format frequency of oval O. Oval O is here, first format frequency is here, second format frequency is here. In written language, from here to here is the same oval O. So we expect theoretically the property or the of the sound to remain same throughout this time interval. In other words, if you look at the second format frequency, F2 value, we expect it to remain same. That means the value should all remain same every 10 milliseconds. What you see here is different. You see that the format frequency was here and it is coming down. It is changing with respect to time by a large margin. It was probably 1800 here, when it came down here, it's probably 1300. Lot variation. So even though we, by written language, with script, we think that this is O, whose property doesn't vary with respect to time, it does vary with respect to time in spoken language. Why does it happen? Happens because our production system is not a machine. It is an analog system, it's not a digital system. It doesn't remain constant up to here O, then suddenly it W. No. Because the speech is produced by the movement of the articulators. The different sounds are produced by different positions of the articulators, and when you want to go from one sound to another sound, change the sound, articulators have to move. They are inertial system, they can't move instantly, they move slowly, and therefore, even when the articulator is saying, the mouth is saying, the brain has already given the signal that the next sound is W, Thiruva. So, next sound is W, this is O, and this is W. Therefore, in anticipation of pronouncing the next sound W, my lips, etc., are already moving towards the position of the W, lips and other articulators. And it so happens that the second format frequency of the W is low. It is known, in fact, it can be shown that the sounds that in all the production place of articulation is bilabial, like pa, ba, wa, and so on, the second format frequencies are lower. So, the format frequency of W is lower, the formal frequency of U is supposed to be here. So since it cannot jump from 1800 to 1200 suddenly, it continuously keeps changing. Therefore, even within a single sound, such as vowel, such as U, the formal frequency keeps changing. Therefore, it is this happens because of the influence of the next sound. It can, the formal frequency value here can be influenced beyond by the previous sound. Is it true? Well, let's look at it. Another example, utterance of the same sound O by the same person in the same word. This is the word Thiruvananthapuram. This word is, this is P, this is U. Let me write the P here. This is again U, and there is an R here, this is A here, and Puram. So there is one more U here, from here to here. So if you look at this U, let's look at the formal frequency of the U here. It is low here and it is increasing. Why is it low initially? Because it is preceded by a bilabial sound, a sound pa, whose place of articulation is lips. So its formal frequency is lower. So the formal frequency increases from the low value corresponding to that sound P to the high value corresponding to that of U. So in this particular case of U, second formal frequency is increasing as a function of time. In contrast, in this particular utterance of the O, in the same sound by the same speaker, second formal frequency is decreasing. Therefore, the formal frequency variation depends upon not only the following sound, but also on the previous sound. So this is called phonetic context effect. So this is not random, it is systematic variation. Therefore, it is important, it may be useful to incorporate this as a feature for speech recognition. Therefore, not only do we measure the formal frequencies at every 10 milliseconds, but also their slopes. Are they increasing or decreasing? But what is the slope? Actually, we measure the slope. So, we measure not only the instantaneous values, but also the slope of the value, how the value changes with respect to time. Slope is computed by first derivative. You can see that sometimes even just slope is not sufficient. Even a curvature may be necessary. You see the variation of these fourth and fifth formal frequency of the vowel A. It is within this one's vowel A, it decreases and increases. Whereas the fifth formal frequency increases and decreases. This is because of the effect of the previous and the following sound. Therefore, not only slope is important, but also the curvature is important. And curvature is measured using the second derivative of the function. For the sake of illustration, I showed how the formants vary. Estimating the formant frequency is a tricky job. It's not that much reliable. On the other hand, our goal is to characterize the smooth log power spectrum, which is done by the Kestrel analysis. So, in practice, we don't use the formants and their derivatives as features. Instead, we use male frequency capture coefficients and their derivatives as the features. Therefore, as a function of time, we not only compute the MFCC, 13 MFCC coefficients every 10 milliseconds, but also their slopes and curvatures. And their slopes and curvatures are estimated. Slope is estimated using this formula, where delta cap is essential slope. The curvature is called delta delta cap or delta square cap. Therefore, at every 10 millisecond, not only do we compute 13 capsule coefficients, but also their derivatives. So that concludes the feature extraction or signal processing block of this block diagram of the general pattern recognition. Signal processing involves whatever signal that we get is analog signal. It is digitized using A to D converter. That's the first step. And whatever digital signal is there, that is broken into short frames, each frame of duration 25 milliseconds, but they are shifted by 10 milliseconds. Therefore, every 10 milliseconds, if a waveform is converted into male frequency capture coefficients, first 13 capture coefficients are retained, and their slope of these 13 coefficients is also measured, therefore you get 13 slope values, similarly you get 13 curvature values. Therefore, every 10 millisecond you get 39 values, 13 coefficient values, 13 slope values, 13 curvature values. The set of these 39 features can be considered as a 39 dimensional vector, because then we can do the analysis in the vector space. Analysis becomes somewhat simpler to write. So every 10 milliseconds we get a 39 dimensional vector. So first 10 milliseconds we get a 39 dimensional vector, let's call it x1. Another next 10 milliseconds, that is 11th millisecond to 20th millisecond, we get another 39 dimensional feature vector, let's call it x2, and so on. If my speech that consists of, let's say, 1.5 seconds, then we get 150 feature vectors. Capital T is 150. In the hidden Markov terminology, these are called observations, but that is later. So here we conclude the signal processing block of a pattern recognition.